Greetings. My name is Francisco Aragon, and I direct Letras Latinas, the literary initiative at the University of Notre Dame's Institute for Latino Studies. Welcome to Curated Conversations, a Latinx poetry show. Today's program is our seventh installment and features Sara Lupita Olivares in conversation with Iliana Rocha, discussing Sara's book, Migratory Sound, which was selected by Roberto Tejada as winner of the most recent edition of the CantoMundo Poetry Prize and published last year by University of Arkansas Press. Before I pass the baton to and introduce Iliana, I want to thank the Writers' Center, our host, starting above all with Zach Powers, their Director of Communications. It's been such a pleasure working with Zach, and he is the person who designed the lovely webpage for the series and is also our tech guru when it comes to recording these sessions. Gratitude as well to Executive Director Margaret Melanie for her encouragement. I also want to acknowledge the Writers' Center's in-house publication, Poet Lore, another co-presenter. A program as ambitious as this would not be possible without funding. The Poetry Foundation is our principal institutional benefactor. I also want to thank Jim Wilson, whose generous patronage is making possible a parallel book club component for the debut books we've been exploring throughout the year. Duende District Bookstore, run by Angela Spring, is a crucial partner in this regard and is also a co-presenter. One of the special traits of Curated Conversations is that we ask our debut Latinx poet in question to select their interlocutor. Sara Lupita Olivares selected Iliana Rocha, who is the author of Karankawa, selected a few years ago by Joy Harjo, current U.S. Poet Laureate, as winner of AWP's Donald Hall Prize for Poetry. Of the book, Harjo writes, "This collection, in essence, embodies a fresh kind of creation story emerging from the Americas." Poet critic Rigoberto Gonzalez writes, "It is a book that honors the dead, the past, and the history of the foundations, culture, family, memory, upon which the living build their futures." In an interview, Iliana says, "The origin story of Karankawa begins with the death of my aunt who lived in Lake Jackson, Texas. I was in a unique position to observe the myriad ways each member of my family deconstructed versions of grief. It was important for me to attempt to capture the multidimensional qualities of grief and loss while also interrogating the grand narratives of my family." The key term here, I think, is interrogating. At the risk of oversimplifying, what I so admired about this collection, which I recently completed, is that it's a book about family without being, on the surface, about family. In other words, she deploys what I'll call various lenses in order to carry out her interrogations. Her second book, The Many Deaths of Inocencio Rodriguez, is forthcoming from Tupelo Press. Iliana is currently an assistant professor at the University of Tennessee in Knoxville. Let me wind this down by sharing this six-line piece from her debut book, which was published by University of Pittsburgh Press, and which speaks to what I'll call the nuanced erotics that permeate a number of her lyric poems. Origin. You said we were where life began. Only matter preceded us. Andromeda, Orion, which you claimed were metallic nipples anticipating fingertips. As I listened to your history, I let my fingers glide your skin. the bones underneath enduring as wood. Open me, you said. I did. Please welcome Iliana Rocha.
Francisco, thank you so much for that beautiful, beautiful introduction. Wow. I just want to express my gratitude for being here and part of this much needed series and to be talking with my good friend, Sara, who I'll now introduce formally. Sara Lupita Olivares is the author of Migratory Sound from the University of Arkansas Press, which was selected as winner of the 2020 CantoMundo Poetry Prize, and the chapbook Field Things, which is through Dancing Girl Press. Her poems have appeared or are forthcoming in the New York Times, Gulf Coast Magazine, Bennington Review, Salt Hill Journal, Quarterly West, and elsewhere. She currently lives in New Mexico, where she is an assistant professor of English at New Mexico Highlands University. And Sara and I have had the pleasure of knowing each other for a few years now. We met in Kalamazoo, Michigan, because we both earned our PhDs at Western Michigan University. And we also have like a similar movement of Texas to the Midwest. And I know we'll talk more about that trajectory a little bit later in our conversation, as well as literal and figurative migration. I also hope that it comes across what a huge fan I am of Sara's work with my line of inquiry this afternoon. I am just such a huge fan of this work. And I've told Sara this before, but I haven't quite read work like this. And I've told her this before, but it bears repeating. And I'm so excited to begin our conversation with a few poems that Sara has chosen to set the tone for this discussion. So I will hand it over to Sara.
Thank you, Iliana. And thank you, Francisco, for organizing this. And I'm Iliana, I'm so grateful to have you and to know you and that you can be here. So so I will start with, I'll read like three poems and then we can chat. Drawings of a red-billed pigeon. You can see only the shape of the red-billed pigeon in the bathroom window. Opaqueness, a distance, the yard repeats. The moon sinks, its persistence a syllable swelling through the day. A child draws worry as a river, its stones neatly pressed to one side. When we take a photograph of the landscape, we find ghosts of trees in ways dimming around themselves to create indentations of other selves. I come home and empty out someone else's drawers. The blurriness of trees deepens, though the periphery remains pointed as if to highlight. Interiority being a complicated resolve. The red-billed pigeon halfway hatched from its egg, its shell a root taken from a landscape and turned upside down. Our own want left to unplace its things within idled forms. You can hear a singing still before opening, the self quietly separated from its own sound. Night. Before loss, there is habit, the moon implied beyond a fence. Outside, a goat crosses the pavement, hooves circle in the snow, a broken jaw reassembled. I begin to make a house despite the highway. What song into the child's ear subtracts an animal's forage end to end? The wrong leaves have been eaten. Each absent correspondence bleats. You misinterpret the animal's mouth as objectivity, each unparticular way of seeing. Glimpse. It takes nothing, the many flowers beheaded, the grass empty and uninhabited. Transplanted, the roots hang anonymous and empty. The letter begins in feigned humility. A wheel without spokes radiates the unseen value of timid sound, its response empty. In the drawings of seas and mountains, a doe spotted but camouflaged, the sea nearly uprooted, where rocks emerge and empty. Sometimes a person posed in a garden, the portrait peering back, and others the flowers are cut, placed in a vase, this movement empty. The public and private conflated in a dream sequence, the sinew of my own intrusion, we find the map, name scribbled, following, empty. There is a complete list, and I wonder what occurs when order disappears out of forgetfulness or in being diminished by wear, intention then empty. Surrender or lack of will in nature becomes unnoticeable in its disorder, a perfectly intact bird dead under the dogwood, its shadow cast empty. When bending the neck to drink from the river, when tilting the head back or forward to sleep, the invisible navigation embedded, followed, empty. It is not a mistake when the rustling quiets and then stops. The animal remains hidden. Lupita meaning little wolf, one's own habitat empty.
Thank you so much, Sara. And that's one of my favorite poems in the collection. I love a good guzzle. I love that. So I'm so glad that Francisco mentioned this idea of an origin story. That's the first thing I wanted to ask you is, what is the origin story of this collection and who or what were your influences for this?
Okay. So I recently did an interview at the Boiler, and the first question was, how long did it take you to write this manuscript? And I had written 9 years, but I realized it's like seven. So it's not quite as grueling of a process. But I started it when I was in Texas getting my MFA. And I think that it took me a few years to really like write the poems that would go in the manuscript or to kind of get a direction. And then, I moved to New York for a few years and then wrote some poems there and then went back to Michigan for my PhD and finished the manuscript there. So I see all of these places as very formative for the manuscript and necessary. So with Texas, I think that was the first time of being away from family. And I wanted sort of like intuitively to go to Texas because that's where my grandmother and her sisters and brother crossed the border and lived in Brownsville, and they would come up to Michigan. And so I wanted to kind of like be in that space and just explore it. So, and then I lived in New York, and I think that transition was really, really, I mean, it was hard for me because we had lived like in an artist commune in Texas and like in the middle of nowhere. And then we're in the city where everything was like metal. And so I could feel myself, like my psyche, like shifting of kind of like having that sort of peace from being in nature and then kind of like that being disrupted. And then when I went to Michigan, that was also just important in sort of talking to my family and exploring it a little bit more. And and I think just during that time, it just became more apparent, like those divisions of place. And I don't think that the manuscript would have concluded in the ways that it did, you know, if I hadn't gone back. And I think, I mean, moving around is just interesting because you have a home, but then you become like an outsider in ways. So, but still part of it, you know? So I think it was important for me to have that widened perspective. So I think that was important to the manuscript. And let me see here, what else? I don't know. And I think with influences, there's kind of a range, with thinking about it. I know like early on, Laurie Nitaker was really important to me and kind of looking at natural spaces and allowing poems to be small if they want to be, and just seeing how one like absorbs space and goes back to those roots. And who else? Vibe Francis, she was someone who's important and kind of like thinking about nature, and especially for like writers of color and what nature writing means. And who else? Sandra Lim was someone that I turned to a lot. James Wright is someone that I love for images. I'm probably forgetting lots of things. So.
Well, this is actually perfect, because the next question I wanted to ask was about your approach to the pastoral. And you mentioned Vivi Francis, and I'm thinking of her anti-pastorals. Mm-hmm. What do you see that you're writing in the tradition of like a Vivi Francis pastoral, anti-pastoral, or like a romantic pastoral? What do you see as the role of the natural world in the collection, and more specifically of the Midwest?
Yeah, I mean, I'm always, I love romanticism. And I love just kind of what writers like Dorothy Wordsworth or Charlotte Smith or Keats, what they teach us about being in nature. And there's this like tradition of, it's called like the greater romantic lyric, of going out in nature and sort of talking to yourself or talking to this absent other, and then seeing what emerges and having this sort of like epiphany that can happen. So I do see that as a form that I think that I follow. And I think, I mean, definitely romanticism is tricky because it is always a lot of like the same men that we think of for it. And so, so I think that it's good that, you know, women and women of color are rewriting these sort of narratives and things. And I think Vivi Francis, her work was really influential just in allowing the sort of warped quality of the pastoral to come in, and allowing it to be like imperfect, and allowing it to like overtake you, you know, and allowing it to be like a force that is complicated, that you're trying to understand, and that it's part of you, but you don't know how necessarily. And so, yeah. And I think for me, the pastoral, it felt like a natural tradition with me leaving and returning. And so the pastoral tradition is defined by being sort of like driven out of, you know, like an urban space and needing to go to nature. And so, why it is that we need those spaces, and, the idea of like Jory Graham, like for, that nature is necessary for like mental formation, which I follow the idea of like, you need to kind of like be alone, and you need to be kind of outside of comfort. And the pastoral, I think, is really interesting because there's that division of place. So I think in writing, I was drawn to looking at paintings of pastorals where you can see these idyllic spaces, but then in the background you can see the city. So there's this constant like presence of what's outside of the frame. And what I think is kind of like heartbreaking about the pastoral is that it's an illusion. So you go to this place and, you know, it's perfect, like, but then you have to leave. And so I think specifically too for being in the Midwest, when I came back to Michigan, I saw the presence, you know, of like the factories and the fields. And that was what brought my family to Michigan, like the roots that are there. So my grandmother and her sisters and brother would like come up and do field work, and then they would go back to Texas. And then eventually they relocated and worked in the factories. And so, and my mom and dad worked in the factories, and so I think that division of like natural spaces and then looking at the smokestacks, you know, and having those like reminders of it's not just like this cushiony nature, you know, there's these hauntings kind of around it.
Yeah, that contention feels really present in your poems. And I was wondering if you could read maybe a couple of the poems that maybe speak through that contention a little bit more.
All right, I'll read Circuit. Circuit, somewhere above shadow contradicts its shape. Any instance in the ghost will unhinge its loneliness where it recognizes its past. In one version, the pasture is a complicated tradition where moss gathers on the roof, the mind sees a plane. In another version, the pasture feels the doe's teeth. In a forethought, the many flowers give, where the seen and implied become patterned. Another's currency is abstraction. Victor's hand cut off in a machine at the paper mill down the street. Each morning, the sulfuric air, my inheritance is a dialogue of transgressions, the sound and shape of the landscape omitted. I have a poem, Pastoral, so I'll read that one. Within the pond, there is an incidental pond. A sheep's wool yellows and curls away from sun. Immobility becomes an act of reasoning. An orchid misplaced opens. How a place comes to exist only in its repetition. Blue smokestacks in the periphery. At night, the woods call back their animals, each note errorless and audible.
Thanks, Sarah. And what I find really provocative about Circuit is that there's no guiding punctuation in this. It's basically just a series of maybe some run-on fragments and phrases. So I think it really speaks to this, the way that you kind of destabilize that line of demarcation between human and nature, and also like the machine versus the pastoral. So I quite like how you are, you know, technically speaking to that major tension that's kind of, you know, threaded throughout the collection. I'm also thinking of the word unplace, because that's a strange little word that does seem to haunt the collection. How do you see your work deconstructing and reconstructing the idea of place, and how do you differentiate between the idea of displacement and unplace?
Oh, that's a good question. I think with, in terms of place, something that is important to me in my belief system is being lost, and allowing oneself to be lost, and what that allows, and what that sort of like discomfort allows. And so I think that was something that, you know, living in different places has consistently like displaced me in certain ways. And I think with unplacing, maybe that being a sort of uprooting in ways, and taking pieces, I guess, like sort of a sort of like scattering. And, you know, specifically for place, and thinking about, again, like my family is like patterns of movement, and that being something where, it, you know, talking to my family about, like my great grandmother Guadalupe, who lived in Michigan, and she hated Michigan because no one spoke Spanish, and so she ended up like going back to Texas. But this sort of being an outsider, I guess, within place and displacement. So and I think ideas of home are always something that I'm kind of thinking a little bit about, but I think definitely in terms of place, it's something that is important to the collection, and in thinking about, even though you're moving, like what is still present within you, or what shows up in your dreams, and what is still there. So even if you're not there, then it's sort of like following you in certain ways, and it like sort of morphing.
Yeah, and this also connects with this idea that's, you know, another recurrent theme in the collection about inheritance in debt. What do you see as liberating about heritage, and where and how does it keep us bound? And how are you working through that you know, in the poetics.
How does inheritance keep us bound?
Yeah, how does it, where is it liberating, and how, and then where does it keep us bound? Because I mean, that idea of debt, you know, there's a heaviness there, right? And the idea of place, displacement and unplace. So I guess, how do you see, where do you see that freedom? And then where do you kind of see that responsibility?
Okay. Yeah, I think with inheritance, like that's something that I was thinking about all throughout the collection of coming back to Michigan and having a daughter and thinking about, okay, my daughter's in this space and she's part of my lineage. So what does that mean? What am I giving her? What do I want to change? And something that I read, it was, yeah, in this book, the African American and Latinx History of the United States, where it was talking about where like basically 80% of what anyone has is inheritance. And so like, if you don't inherit anything, then you're so disadvantaged, you know? And so like, how do you start and how do you build? And that's just kind of how our country is like set up. So, so I think thinking about that, of just the idea of like what you're given and how you build and everything, and honoring that as well. You know, like I'm very proud of the work that my family did and the work that I am doing for my daughter, you know, and I honor my family, like what they risked and all sorts of things. So yeah, so I'm very grateful, but you know, also thinking about what is owed. And I think in terms of debt, something that I think a lot about is in terms of inheritance, like what sort of signifiers are in place from your ghosts, from your ancestors and things, and how are you working to like reverse those things, and how are you working to make amends, and like what sort of responsibility do you have? And that's something that I always think about, you know, is again, like making things better for my daughter and giving her opportunities that like I didn't have. And I think with debt, there is guilt within that of thinking about, I don't know, what do I owe because, you know, I don't know. Yeah, because I was able to go to school, you know, or things like that. So there's always that sort of like weight, I think, to consider. So.
Yeah, that's great, Sara. I do want to kind of shift to the craft a little bit, because one of the things you had the opportunity to visit my class last fall, because I offered this book in my nature poetry class. Everyone, all the students were like, I want to know about this voice. I want to know about this speaker. I want to be able to write like this. So I find myself to be continuously pulled in to these poems through the speaker and the voice, which, you know, some people have characterized as restrained or spare. And there is a brevity here that you mentioned, as well as like a compression. How do you approach, or how do you attend to voice in this collection? Because I need an education from Dr. Olivares today about this.
Well, yeah, I think that voice is something that for sure has been, I feel like I've had a complicated relationship to voice. And I think that, yeah, it's tricky because I there is a sense of restraint, and I think part of it has to do with I don't know, yeah, like not always having space for my voice or something, and also just thinking about I don't know, I think with editing there's a sense of I don't know, like minimalism that I'm drawn to. But I think in terms of voice specifically, I believe in like self-preservation, and I believe in like if I am writing about things that are connected to other people, like preservation for them as well, you know, and creating distance. And I think when I'm the type of person, like when I write, I like to have distance from what I'm writing about. And so meditation is important to me, and creating that sort of distance so that I'm not going in it and writing something that feels like very emotional or very tied to something, to its subject too directly. And part of that is just like my interest in transforming something so that it's not just this, and letting it be something else, and letting it not just be the identity that I assign to that subject or that situation, but seeing what's around it, I guess. I think that when I talked to your class, I did tell them that I like edit my voice out sometimes, my voice is not present in my poems, but I like to just have that space, and I like to have kind of a timeless quality to them. So I think the big thing would be, I guess, like creating space from whatever it is that I'm writing about, and allowing, Goya Anzaldúa says, images precede language. And so I think about that of like allowing images kind of to have their way of speaking, and sort of getting out of the way, I guess.
Yeah, I'm just taking notes because I told you I'm getting an education today. Do you mind reading a couple of poems that I personally think speak really vividly to voice? Thinking of Collective and On Forgetting.
Okay. Collective. The birds highlight absence. Similarly, we make ourselves appear as though illusory. What does the body begin to owe? Each debt it sinks itself into. And then Unforgetting. The same way we forget birds inside a field. In this small space, we are not thinking of ourselves, though explain a sort of glad displacement.
Thanks, Sara. And I love these two poems because they not only speak to the compression and the brevity, there's also the reference to debt. And then there's the birds. We haven't talked about the animals yet in this collection. I know that you live with a lot of animals.
Yes. Got the whole farm.
Got the whole farm in the book and in your house. And I love that the birds are kind of here because, you know, we always reference them, you know, in terms of migration and what else might they symbolize in the collection. And there's so many other references to bears and deer. How do you see the animals also speaking to either place or displacement?
Let's see here. I think at one point, I mean, I was interested in John Berger's essay, Why Look at Animals? So that was something that I was thinking a lot about, is just sort of like humanizing animals and allowing them to be speakers in their own way or have a presence. And I don't think that there's necessarily always like a rhyme or reason for which animal is going to come into a poem. But I do sort of feel like, animal, if I see you, you're going to be in my poem, you know, where like they just like get in my psyche, I guess, and show up. And I mean, specifically birds. I was interested in the book. What is it? The Portraits of Mexican Birds. And I would use that as a place of sort of departure. Like just looking at the images and kind of thinking about that sense of movement that animals do, and thinking about that and sort of like parallel to my family and everything. And what else was I gonna say about the animals? Yeah, so I think looking at the sort of like images and looking at that sort of like displacement. And I think another thing in terms of movement with like driving and things where I would see different animals and seeing how animals are, you know, products of their environment and, you know, how they coexist and work together and everything, and seeing how they shift and how they adapt and everything. So yeah, I just see animals as like things, beings to learn from and sort of messengers in ways. And yeah, I live with a million cats right now. And because New Mexico, my town, has like a lot of stray cats. And so I can't say no. And then we have our chickens and dogs. So we've got them all.
We gotta get you taking in all the chihuahuas too. That's next.
I know. Yeah, there's chihuahua gangs. So
I know you got. Yeah, you gotta make friends with the chihuahua gangs.
I know, one at a time.
I like what you said about, you know, animals and adapting, and you know, and then there's, you know, living in Michigan. I lived there for 4 years, and also seeing the ways that we force animals to not adapt, like literally we're running over them on, you know, on the highways, and there's a beautiful forest, it's like situating the roads and things. And I just, again, I feel like that speaks to that tension of, you know, human and animal, internal and external world, and, you know, how these kind of collide throughout the poetry. You also mentioned how to look at animals, and I wanted to kind of maybe focus in on this idea of looking, because art and aesthetics seems to be another huge recurring theme throughout the collection. You referenced Da Vinci, you referenced Pierre Bonnard. And one of the things that just struck me about Bonnard's work is that he worked through memory. And so he's described as creating glimpses, and he's been characterized as not having been obliged to paint what was right in front of him, because he's mostly working on impression. And do you kind of feel that your work has a similar consciousness to that? And also, how do you understand the role of observer, artist, and perceiver?
Okay. Sorry, I'm writing down the three, observer, artist, perceiver. Yeah, I think my work is always in this book specifically inspired by Impressionism. And so Bonnard and Monet were people that I turned to. And I think with both of those artists, what I'm drawn to with them is the exploration of light and air. And so I think Monet talked about like how a landscape is like nothing without the air and the light that animates it. So kind of thinking about these unseen forces that are animating it. And so, yeah, so it's like light and air are kind of ghosts or sorts of things, you know, that are these unseeable presence within a painting. So I don't know. Yeah. And I think, yeah, there's them. And then Cornell was someone who was also like important to me, but more specifically like his dream journals. So kind of thinking about this sort of disjointedness of perception and seeing. So yeah, I think that with being the perceiver or the artist, there is, you know, its own sort of responsibility and a sort of like distancing. There's a sense of translation, and I think that's something that I learned from Impressionism was, you know, that you don't have to make something that is an exact depiction of reality. You know, it can have a sort of coding of dream. And I think that's something that goes back to like romanticism, of lifting the veil, you know, of the imagination. And And yeah, and just honoring the imagination and honoring the unseen forces that exist.
That's great. And there also does seem to be like an urgency in your book to identify acts of making, to identify patterns. And some of my favorite lines in the collection are, how a place comes to exist in repetition, caught in a pattern for eternity, and the image of poppies replayed. So there does seem to be like an urgency of wanting to pin something down, like maybe something that's so elusive or slippery or out of reach. And I think that's why the idea of repetition stood out to me so boldly. Can you speak to the idea of repetition and what it might signify in terms of this project?
Yeah, I think the repetition to me sort of, again, kind of goes back to ideas of inheritance and ideas of like looking at what came before, what is still present, what echoes are there, and what echo are you making, you know, within that. And so I think, I don't know, and memory, to me, memory is very repetitive, and maybe because I'm a worrier, so my memory is more repetitive, but yeah, so I think that my thought process is definitely like relooking at things. And I think there's an importance in relooking at things to see something differently or to take a new vantage point and seeing what wasn't seeable before or what comes out. I think that there's a sense of, yeah, wanting to return to something to understand it, and to make sense of it in some way and to know it. So yeah, I see that as maybe the imperative behind it within the book.
That's great. Yeah, and it's that, what is that theory about memory? Is that every time we remember a memory, we don't actually remember the event. We remember the last time we remembered the event. Oh. So it's like this like degradation, right, of every time that we recall that. And that kind of speaks back to the warped quality that you mentioned, the imperfect, the, you know, poet as translator trying to, you know, capture perception, but our perception is inherently subjective. So I think all of this is just speaking to, you know, that the major urgency in the book. And because I am still so struck by the tone, and I know my students were too, I did ask you if you were to create a soundtrack for the collection, what songs or artists would be on there, and like, what kind of mood would you create for this book?
Okay. So Iliana and I didn't really want to know too many of know the questions that she was going to ask me, but I have kind of like a general sort of like skeleton of it, but she did tell me that she was going to ask me about music. So, and I've been thinking about it, and I think that I have two directions that I go with music where music is important to me because like of exercise, like exercise is important for me for like working through things. And that, I mean, like that's such a big part of my writing process is like, okay, like work through it. And then now you can like write whatever, that's like, has that sort of space. So I definitely like honor that music. And then I think for the manuscript, when I think about it, I know I was listening to like Amy Winehouse throughout. You know, she like let me be sad if I wanted to be sad, and like Lana Del Rey, I think she let me be sad too. And I think Lana Del Rey, she's has like bits of being problematic where people are like, stop talking, Lana Del Rey. but I still like think she was important. Let's see here, Odessa, Little Dragon, Nico Case, And someone that I really love is Haley Hendricks. And I think that she has a song, is called Drinking Song. And I think if like the manuscript had a theme song, that that's what it would be, because it has kind of a ballad quality, and where it has like a bit of a somber tone, but it doesn't let you like go down there, you know, like it like keeps you afloat. And there's like a sort of like ancestrally quality to it. But I still also want to honor like my love for Beyonce and Cardi B and Rosalia and like the Necessary Forces. And that, yeah, like my daughter, she likes Taylor Swift. And I was like, well, if you like Taylor Swift, you have to like Rosalia too. So we've been like incorporating those two things. But I do, I mean, like, I think sort of like I said, music like Beyonce or Cardi B, they were important to me just in sort of like thinking about voice of women and thinking about like giving a narrative to like women's experiences that like have not had access to. So I see them as important to my process as well. I don't know if they'd be on my soundtrack, but I see them as like necessary to get to the soundtrack.
You know, I love that. And I mean, Lana Del Rey is, I know so many poets who've been influenced by her, and she's also my guilty pleasure, but I think we can still agree that she's been problematic at times. So we can still say that, you know, she's been an influence to many of us.
Yes, I'm not the only one.
Okay, so in the interest of time, just one last question to kind of close us out. And I just want to thank you, Sara, for inviting me to participate in this. This has been so much fun. What are some of your upcoming projects, if you wouldn't mind sharing? And do you have any new poems that you could read to close this out?
Yes. Well, thank you again for being here and for your beautiful questions. So I can read some new poems. I'm working on my next manuscript, God willing. and so I think, let me see here, with this next set of poems, something that I'm interested in is just ideas of like belief and disbelief and certainty and like what like maybe we can't see that we know is there, and or like we believe is there, and these moments of like sort of turning to faith and or belief, and whether that's like ghosts, whether that's like whoever. So I think these ideas of like what, like these moments of needing to turn to belief. And so I'm drawn to like Our Lady of Guadalupe and kind of looking at that as her as a symbol. She was someone who's like important to me growing up. It's a family name, and just growing up and having it be that like my sisters and I like thought that we saw Our Lady of Guadalupe like on the closet door, you know? And so that just being something that that was like part of our family and part of our narrative. And then also looking at like lives of saints and just these sort of like women who kind of were like not believed or had like visionary qualities and sort of like trusted that and followed that. So looking at like both sides of things. Yeah, so I think that's all I'll say. And the tradition of retablos, so the tradition of where there are these like paintings and they sort of symbolize these moments of difficulty. So if someone like crosses a border, someone was sick and prayed and they're no longer sick, then they'll make these little paintings. And the paintings to me are really interesting because there's this like disembodied quality to them where you're looking at this experience of sort of like trauma of like, I was desperate and I sought faith or sought whatever. And now I'm out of it. So I can like look at myself. And so they're these like self-portraits of themselves, like praying. And then you see like the apparition. And I think there's just something like really eerie to me about that sort of hindsight of like looking, you know, looking back and trying to like understand that moment. So I have like a whole bunch of those. So I'll read one of those and others. Interruptions. It is similar to a dream reaching out with certainty, calling the heron's gray shadow a shadow as it trails through mud along the highway. In one memory, a child sleeps on the other side of the wall. In another, the ghost heaves and you continue dropping laundry along the hallway. In the morning, we exist in prepositions as if someone were looking for the same object in a room, opening and closing, waiting and opening to see perhaps if it is now there. Retablos. It is your privilege speaking fragmented. I was already there, my toes pressed into the mossy earth. In sight, the apparition contradicts its context. When saying there is not a dispute, tourmaline clouds, the animal in stasis begins to disperse. Each account requires a self-reflexivity, hands upward, face averted to speak. It is not your desperation met in the silence, but a sharp edge, the walls gone cold. Worry dictated the animals, the light dimming over the grass, though to love its silence, a scenario chosen over the unknown.